can tell what the Lord has done for me. This might take all day, so I better start right now. And it might get loud, it might get loud. Heaven's coming down.
Past could tell you and tell me this. My God is infinite. good morning, church. If you want to stand as we worship together, we're starting with this song reminding us the joy of the Lord is our strength. So let's sing together. Let's sing. This is the day. Rejoice and be glad, rejoice and be glad in it. This is where I believe. You are more than enough for me. You are faithful, Lord. You are faithful to your promise. You are strong when I am weak. When I'm standing your presence, I have everything I need. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of the Lord, the joy of the Lord is my strength. Yeah. Oh, my soul, bless
shadows. Your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you.
So when I fight,
so when I fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And every fear I lay at your feet, I sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. An almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand.
Nothing can stand against the power of our
Let's take a moment as we're worshiping with this song to remind ourselves is that we have a God that is above all things, who is sovereign, powerful, strong, fighting for us. So maybe you need to sing this song in faith. You're in a battle right now, and you need to sing over your battle. Remind yourself, not of your strength, but of who He is. Our holy God, creator of heaven and earth, the one who has defeated the enemy, He is fighting for us. So let's sing as an act of war, as an act of worship and faith. Almighty Fortress.
An almighty fortress, You go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, You win every battle.
Someone needs to hear that.
Nothing can stand against the power of Almighty, an almighty fortress. You go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows. You win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God.
Yes, Lord.
Thousand generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb.
Your name,
Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them
all thrones,
all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions. Your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, You are lifted high, holy, holy forever.
If you've been forgiven and if you've been redeemed, sing the song forever to the Lamb.
Your name.
just with your own words, sing out your own song of worship, declaring that He is holy, He is righteous, there is none beside Him, He is worthy, He and He alone.
Beside
That song is referencing out of Matthew chapter 7. Therefore, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise person who built their house on a rock. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house or that life. Yet it did not fall because it had its foundation on the rock. But everyone who hears these words of mine and does not put them into practice is like a foolish person who built their house on the sand. The rain came down, the streams rose, and the winds blew and beat against that house, that life, and it fell with a great crash. Storms come, wind blows, rain falls, floods come to both houses. One house is not shaken. The other house not only is shaken, but goes down. Life is like that. Rains come, storms go, earthquakes come, all kinds of things happen in life that we're not prepared for all the time. The only thing we can do to prepare is this. Everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like someone who built their house on a rock and it did not fall. So I want to remind some of us this morning that no matter if the rain is blowing right now in your life, no matter if the things are shaking, no matter if the floodwaters are rising, that our hope is not that the rain will just stop. Our hope is not that things will stop shaking. Our hope is not that everything's just going to get calm in my life. My hope is that I will be built on a strong and a firm foundation, the person of Jesus Christ. Not what's going on around me, not what's going on in my life, but that I will be built on the strong and a firm foundation of Him who is Jesus. So if you're going through a storm right now, I want to pray with you. If your things are shaking for you right now, I want to pray. Go through life together. So if you're going through a bit of a storm right now, if things are shaking a little bit right now, can you just raise your hand in the room real quick? We want to pray together. If there's a hand around you and you're a follower of Jesus, ask them if you can pray for them. Just pray. Don't ask them for, this is not a counseling session. Just pray whatever God gives you. Pray a prayer of blessing. Pray a prayer of release. Pray a prayer of hope. Pray a prayer of God's love to be poured out upon them. All around the room, there's hands. Keep your hand up until someone comes and prays for you. And pray like you wish someone would pray for you. Thank you, Lord Jesus, for your power. Thank you, Lord, for your power moving right now in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, that you're setting at liberty. Thank you, Lord, that you're bringing hope. Thank you, Lord, that you're in the storm with people right now. May they sense and know you're clear and present. Your love being poured out. Pour out your love, Lord. Pour out your love, Lord. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Oh, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Your people. Thank you for your power. Thank you for your love. Thank you that you're grateful that you are not a God who's just in heaven someplace. You're not a God who's a little idol or a rock or a stick, but that you are a God who is alive. You rose up from the grave. You defeated death, hell, and the grave. That you are Emmanuel, God with us. You are the God who was. You are the God who is. You are the God who is to come. That in Jesus, if that same spirit that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you, it will quicken you. It will cause you to come alive. It will cause you to be one who overcomes the power of heaven present in the person of Jesus and in our lives because he's with us. In the strong name of Jesus, and everyone said, amen and amen. You may be seated. Give someone a high five as you sit down. Thank you, worship team. Thank you, thank you. How many of you are enjoying the new spring season of that bright orb in the sky? Sunshine, it's great. How many of you have, yesterday someone brought over a junk trailer and put it in my driveway and they were just gonna park it there. And while it was parked there, I filled it up. With all the things from my backyard that needed to come out of the backyard and have been waiting there. Spring cleaning is good. Cleaning up things, it's really good on the inside of your house. It's also good in our lives. Good opportunity, and that's what we're going to be looking at over the next little while, just talking about how Jesus is going to help us be all that he's called us to be. But how many of you have ever tried to change something or change someone? Changing someone else is often how we approach the issues of our life. But I've been trying to change something just in the last while. I need to give you a little update on the saga of the mice in our house. Because I'm hearing that there's a lot of people that have mice issues or know someone that does. Is that true? Is there anybody, do you know someone right now is fighting and battling the mice? Thankfully not the rats, just the mice. And so over the last number of weeks, since about mid-January in that cold snap, we've been doing what we can to deal with the mice. Because I don't like mice. Mice are meant to live outside, not in my house. Amen. Yeah, if you couldn't have said amen to anything today, you could have said amen to that. And so they came through and we found out where they were coming in, the smallest of little, small little places. And we covered that and then we started the battle of beating them slowly by little bit, helping them go to a better place. And the count was at 5 and the last one that was seen was 2 weeks ago. No, Vic. I was sitting reading my Bible early in the morning and I saw the light is on and this one walked out. He had all the attitude and everything, walked out, and then just walked across the floor, went under the stove, and was hanging out there. I was like, oh, my goodness. Because I found this thing out. There are certain products that you give them to help them move to a better place. They work at a certain rate of speed. The gestation period of mice is quicker than the speed of the food that you give them to help them go to a better place. So I feel like I may be in a battle for a while. And so I'm fighting against them. So we've covered the holes. Yesterday I had screen going anywhere place and I'm putting foam and screen and I'm doing things. I have swept my floor and I think I'm starting to take the finish off of it. Anything that might be there as an attractant to a mouse, I'm sweeping, I'm vacuuming. I've got my 18-month-old grandchild doing duty, vacuuming, cleaning everything up. I'm doing whatever I can because I don't want any mice in my life. And this morning I'm sitting and I'm praying and I'm doing my devotions and one walked out again, the same one, doing his thing. Went under the fridge and he went and stuck his head out a little while later. So we'll be having a chat a little bit later today. We'll be doing our thing. But sometimes things that we think should change are not easy to change. Has anybody else ever tried to change something in their life? And they don't always happen quickly. They happen little by little, often, the things in our life. I know, for example, in 2019, prior to a pandemic, I was about 20 pounds lighter than I am right now. But little by little, day by day, bag of chips by bag of chips, I slowly have increased my... we'll just leave it at that. Leave it at that. But the reality is it happens little by little. And we want change, but we don't always want change. If you struggle with procrastination, when are you going to make change? Next week. Or if you're fearful, you're too afraid to make the changes that are needed. I read an article this week about a nation, and they talked to a young man who is in dire straits with his addiction. And he said, I despise what is happening, and I don't want to do it, but I love it. And that's often how it is with the issues of our life. We despise them, we don't want them anything to do with them, but somehow we put up with them. Maybe that's just me, or the person beside you. Look at them and say, I think he's talking to you. And there are all kinds of things in our life. And not just the big issues that we put into some, these are the big deals, the addiction issues, certainly those, but also things like guilt, things like shame, things like perfectionism, things like all the issues that every one of us, if we had a sign in front of us right now, what we're dealing with, the comparison, the anger, the lust, the depression, the discouragement, the bitterness, the bad habits, the addiction to pornography, all of the things that we say, I want to be free from them, but somehow I'm not. And sometimes we know why we act the way we do. It's just our sinful behavior. Other times, we don't know why we act the way we do. It just happens, seemingly. Sometimes it's in response to the sin that has been done against us. Someone hurt you. Someone abandoned you. Someone abused you, and your response has been less than what you would want it to be, destructive and hurtful for your own life and for the lives of those around you. Marriage issues, and sometimes the things that we're going through are because we just go with the flow of what's going on in our world and in our culture, a me-centered, immoral, all about ourselves, our comfort, culture that we live in, what looks good, what feels good for me. And I want you to think about for yourself this morning, because as I was preparing for this, I thought the danger of this could be, as we talk about this, that if you don't have any presenting issue per se where you're struggling with an addiction and a substance and those kind of things, you could say, I don't think he's talking to me. But unless you have become like Jesus, because our goal is not to be better than the person beside us, or not even to be a better version of what we were when we grew up, but our version is to be, our hope is to become like Jesus. So if you're not like Jesus right now, you got some growth to do. I don't care if you're 84 or you're 44, because when you're 44 is very old. If you're 17 right now, you're like, that person is close to death. But 44, or if you're 14, we all have stuff that Jesus wants us to be free from. Everyone in the room. There is a level of freedom that you are not experiencing right now that Jesus wants for you. Everyone. Because you're not, none of us have arrived and are like Jesus yet. How many of you like ice cream? Thank God for ice cream. You're like, where? He just did a hard right. So for me, I don't have ice cream in the freezer very often for two reasons. One, if it's there, I eat it all. If it's there, I eat it all. So I can't have it there because I have an issue with ice cream. And you might be someone who doesn't like ice cream. You're like, I can't believe he struggles with that. Can you believe that he struggles with just like eating ice cream anytime he wants? He can't control himself. I wish that, my pastor has, I'm going to have to pray for him. You should pray for me anyway, but see, you might be critical of my issue because you don't have that issue. But if I went to you and asked around the people around you, hey, what's that person struggle with? Or ask you yourself. It might not be ice cream. It might be lying. It might be eating samosas until your eyes just water. I don't know what it might be. But the point being that your issue is your issue, but it's not just the issue. And just because someone else has an issue that's different than you doesn't mean that you shouldn't allow the Lord to look at you. I'm just going to mess around with you a little bit, but I'm okay with that. Because I think the Lord wants to get in to our business a little bit because he wants us to be free a whole lot more. And we're going to talk about that a little bit today. Because Jesus' first sermon, he declared that the Spirit of the Lord had anointed him to bring freedom. Somebody say freedom. Freedom. And everybody in the room can use more freedom. The Spirit of the Lord came upon Jesus, and he came to help people break out of prisons that had long held them captive. In Luke 4 and 18 to 19, it says, this is Jesus speaking and quoting out of the Old Testament. He said, the Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. So anybody who is in need in any way, here is some good news right now. Anybody who hasn't arrived, there's some good news coming your way. Anybody who doesn't have it all together, there's some good news for you. Anybody who's not perfect, there's some good news for you right now. Here it is. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners, to break us out, recovery of sight for the blind. In other words, you can have a vision for your future that right now you cannot see, but Jesus has come to bring freedom and recovery of sight to the blind. He came to set the oppressed free. He came to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, that you could have a great life, that you could have a life marked by the favor of God, that you could have a life that's marked by God's goodness flowing in you, flowing for you, flowing through you. I believe it. Jesus is who he said he is. Freedom is your inheritance in Jesus. Freedom is your birthright in Jesus. You were born again in Jesus for freedom. You were born again in Jesus to be awakened to a new life, filled with hope, filled with purpose, filled with identity in him. You were not born for bondage. You were not born to get by. You were not born for less than. He came and spoke to the people that were in those spaces. Whatever has happened in our life to this point, Jesus comes in and says, I have come that you might have life and have it to the full. There might be a devil out there that has come to steal, and you've seen it in your life, have come to kill, and you've seen it in your life, has come to destroy, and you've seen it in your life. But Jesus comes in and breaks in and says, but I have come that you might have life and life to the full. But see, eventually we start there, but eventually all of us come to a part or a point where we bump up against something or some situation that seems to stop us. And we stop moving forward and we stop dreaming. It might be circumstantial, it might be a personal issue, but a dream of a life marked by hope and purpose and fulfillment and joy and meaning seemingly becomes elusive at best and impossible at worst. Or you put it to somebody else, it's for somebody else, Craig, it's not for me. If you knew where I came from or you knew the things that I have walked through, I've survived and that's good enough. Or you put it off to another day, maybe sometime in the future, or you put it off to heaven and say, then it'll all be good, and it will be all good. But Jesus came that you might have life and have it to the full today, and came that you might have life and have it for your future, for your family's future, that the blessing of the Lord would touch you, would flow on you, and would flow through you to touch the world around you, that people would come to know who Jesus is and the goodness of Jesus because he's showing up in your life. But something happens along the way where we start to resign our life to less than. Unfulfilled expectations might be one of them, where we experience disappointment, where the prayer is not answered in the speed we wish it were, or it's not answered in the way we wish it were. Sometimes it's yes, sometimes it's no, sometimes it's wait, and sometimes I don't understand. Maybe you had bad things happen to you and you say, where it shouldn't have happened to me, and you've been disappointed, and you start to live less. Or maybe there's unrelenting doubt, where all of us might experience doubt at varying degrees at varying times. But this kind of doubt is unrelenting. It's seemingly whispered in your ear all the time, and you start to question God's reality. You start to question God's promises. You start to question God's goodness. You start to question your life in God. Or it might be the unchangeable circumstances where there's a defeatism. This is where things just don't seem to move, and we start to believe that there is no hope for us in our situation. We tolerate what we were never meant to tolerate, or we live with what we were never meant to live with. Undealt with issues, denial. This is where we live with all kinds of things that we haven't dealt with. We might acknowledge that they're there, but we are reluctant to confront our stuff, our sin, our pain, our secret struggles, our character flaws, the things done to us. They're there, but we're all affected by the sin of our own life. We're all affected by the sin that's done against us. We're all affected by the sin of the world around us. But we do not have to live the rest of our lives victimized and re-victimized by what has happened, by what's going on around us. Whatever has been done by us, to us, around us, we were made for freedom. We were made for you. It's God's heart for you. It's God's heart for you. Not just for somebody else who hasn't had the things that you've had, but God's heart for you is this, out of Exodus 3, 7 and 8. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people. God sees you. God sees you right now. In the middle of your mess, in the middle of your problem, in the middle of your challenge, in the middle of that thing that is that besetting sin that seems to entangle you, he sees you. And not only that, he's seen the misery of his people. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers. God has heard every prayer that's been whispered in the quietness of your own room, in the sobbing of your heart, in the wonderings of where things are going to turn around, when they're going to turn around. I want to tell somebody today that God has heard you. And he's moving. And he says not only has he heard, but he is concerned about their suffering. He cares. And so I have come down to rescue you. God is at work. God sees you. That's his heart. God hears you. That's his heart. God cares. That's what he feels. And God is at work. And biblical freedom allows us to reclaim what the enemy has robbed from us so we can live out the story of what God has written for your life. It's about being who and doing what God created you for, and or who he created you to be, and what he's created you to do. That's what it is. Because worldly freedom says it's about me and my way, being who and doing what I feel I should be and doing what I feel I should do. But Jesus came to set us free so that we do not have to be bound to the things of our past. We don't have to be bound to the things of our upbringing. We don't have to be bound to the sins of our generations. We don't have to come under the pain and the trauma of a father walking out of our life or someone abusing us. We can walk beyond the injustice, through the failures. And freedom is what Jesus came to do. Galatians 3 and 22 says this, but the scriptures declare that we are all prisoners of sin. But that's not the end of the story. So we receive God's promise of what? God's promise of what? Freedom. God's promise of what? Freedom. Who's it for? Only by believing in Jesus Christ. And it goes on to say in chapter 5 of that same book that so Christ has truly set us free. Now make sure you stay free. In other words, it's possible that you could go back to what you were. You could go back to that thing that had you at one time. And you can't ever stay in the spot of I've arrived and I've got it all together and I've figured life out, and if you could just be like me, your life would be amazing. Be very careful that you stay free and don't allow yourself to be entangled. So scripture is warning us and inviting us at the same time. Freedom sometimes comes instantly, but more often than not, it's a process or a process, depending where you're from. See, life is all about process. We see this in agriculture, where a garden just doesn't appear. You have to till the ground, you have to sow the seed, and then you have to water it, and after some time you will eventually get a harvest. Children come the same way, through a process, from a moment of conception through to in utero, until one day they're born, and it doesn't end there. Then they start, and they don't just are not born as an adult, and the women say, thank God for that. They grow into that. They get little, they have no teeth. They get some teeth. The teeth fall out. The teeth come in. They get some hair. The hair falls. No, that's a different thing. Changing habits is a process. It takes time to establish new ways of living. And the transformation of a caterpillar to a butterfly is a process. Life is about process. And God's built the world like that, and he's built change like that. It's almost always. Sometimes, and we're grateful for stories of instantaneous help, but there's still a process of walking that out. Something happens, and then you have to walk it out. And the process of freedom is God in his grace, but it's also you and me. We have to do our part. Some people want to say, oh, it's all up to God. Other people are over here, I just got to work harder, do more work, and I'll figure it out, and I'll just keep grinding and grinding and grinding. And no, it's all up to God. No, it's both. It's both. It's God at work. But what does this say in Philippians 2:12? It is God who works in you to will and to do according to his purpose. In other words, he gives you the power, but you got to respond. You got to give him your yes. You got to follow him. You got to choose to get up and move. But he gives you the power and the grace on the inside. 1 Corinthians 12:9, Jesus said, my grace is sufficient, or my power is sufficient for you, but my power is made perfect in your weakness. In other words, you don't have to have it all together, but you got to give him your yes. And then you can access the power source, but it starts with you. The process of freedom, my part, it means moving, first of all. And these are the principles we're going to be looking at over the next number of weeks. Moving from denial to confession. Denial to confession. Admitting that we need freedom is a particular area, in any area I should say, is the first step towards a breakthrough. You can't change what you will not acknowledge. We need to move out of denial and into reality and say, I need help. John Bevere, a Christian author, written many, many books, he says this. He said, God first will warn you personally, then he will warn you privately, and then he will expose you publicly if you don't respond. Personally is the best time to respond. Now, right now, some of you are getting warned privately by the Lord. Getting warned privately and respond is up to you. To move from denial to confession. I need the help of heaven. Number two, move from excuses to responsibility. We have a natural tendency to want to blame others. Do you know that every fight that we had in our marriage for the first 3 years was Shanda's fault? It took a while, but I got her to understand that if she would just grow and become who God called her to be, that we would stop having fights and quarrels. No, still not happening. I have my part. Move from excuses. Yeah, but if you wouldn't have. We had this saying in our house. One of our kids, all of our kids at various times would say, you made me do this. I was like, wow, your sister has superpowers. She can make you mad and wind you up and get you running around the room screaming, look at the power. And they would be like, Dad. And I wanted them to learn from a very young age, your response is your responsibility. Because every one of us have challenging, difficult, painful, and around the room we could compare scars and show and everything like that. But we need to move from excuses to responsibility if we want to see freedom. Move from independency to community. We live in a self-help world, but the truth is we need the help of the people around us to encourage us, to strengthen us, to challenge us, hold us accountable where we've said we wanted them to hold accountable. We need people. We move from complacency to contending. We have to ask ourselves whether we really want to be free. Whatever your one thing is, because sometimes we can find comfort and security in the things that hold us captive or we think we have. And over the years, a prison can become like a home to us. An issue can become our identity instead of something we're meant to win over. Freedom can require a lot of change, a lot of adjustment, but not everyone is willing to pay the price for freedom. And then finally move from lethargy to vigilance. There's a continual battle for your freedom, and each one of us are only one bad decision away from wrecking everything. Vigilant. But this is not a self-help and work harder gospel. Good news. It's not the good news of grin and bear it. It's not the good news of guts and grit. But as Christ followers, we respond to and we cooperate with Jesus. He's the source of power. It's God who works in you to will and to do according to his good pleasure. We can see that reflected in Exodus chapter 6 and 6 to 7. Therefore say to the Israelites, I'll give some context in a moment. I am the Lord, and I will bring you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians. I will free you from being slaves to them. I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with mighty acts of judgment. I will take you as my own people, and I will be your God. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God who brought you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians. So this scripture was recited by Jewish people for thousands of years, coming out of the Old Testament during Passover, with four different cups of wine represent with four different statements, and each part of the statements represents a greater and a growing level of redemption or freedom that builds off the previous. Each cup of wine had a different meaning and a different blessing, and we see these fulfilled in Jesus, the one who died, was buried, and rose again in newness of life to give us life to the full. And he opens new possibilities for every one of us. We are not our past. We are not our upbringing. We are not our culture. We are not our pain. We are not our trauma. We are not what someone cursed us with. We are meant to be, and the possibilities are open to us, to be who God called you, created you to be. And he opens new possibilities. He said, someone can take this platform away, or the pulpit. Which one's that first one? Okay. So this is the first cup that they would have. I will bring you out from under the yoke. This is called the cup of sanctification, they called it, which is where God sets us apart and he saves you. And we're thankful that that's the beginning part of our journey in God, that he saves us. He brings us out from the yoke. It's like he opens a prison door and says, step out. And we step out, and the place that we had been small and held captive in, suddenly we're outside. And we realize that, wow. And what he was talking about, the people of God had been held captive for over 400 years and had been brutalized and victimized, their children taken from them, not being able to go where they wanted to go, not able to worship like they wanted to worship. And in a moment, they were set free. And this is the starting point of our journey in Jesus. In a moment, you can be set free. And he saves you and breaks the power or the yoke. That's like what an animal to control it. The control is broken over your life. And we're thankful for that. And Jesus said it this way. Very truly I tell you in John 5 and 24, whoever hears my word and believes in him who sent me has eternal life and has crossed over from death to life. Something happens in a moment because of Jesus. And we access this cup and the power of it, the potential of it, by surrendering our life to Jesus. It's the start. surrender. Sanctification, being saved for God's purpose, is activated by surrender. It starts here, but it doesn't end there. Because some of us think this is all that our life is about. But we move on to, I will free you from being slaves. This is the cup of deliverance. This is where God heals you. See, because you came out of the prison and you came out of the spot that you're in, you still think like you're in the prison. And so what this cup is about, sometimes it's instantly where there's powerful deliverance, but more often than not, it's the cup of deliverance is steps of obedience, little bit by little bit, day by day. Because, and I don't know if you've ever noticed this, but if you read Genesis or Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, they are very prescriptive. Here's how you handle your finances. Here's how you treat your wife. Here's how you treat your animals. Like all the things was very prescriptive because they were teaching slaves how to live. And God wants to teach you not just to save you, but teach you how to live. And this cup of deliverance is accessed through confession and repentance. You need other people. Confession and repentance. James 5 says this, confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. I've been saved and sanctified, but now I'm learning how to live and I can be healed. Healing is a result of confession and repentance, breaking the power of generational patterns, breaking the power of wrong thinking that gets you into all kinds of trouble all the time, breaking the power of not knowing how to handle things, not knowing how to live, because you can be brought out from under the yoke, but then Jesus doesn't stay there. He says, I want to free you from thinking and living like a slave. And then we go on to the cup of redemption. This is where God restores you. He saved you. He delivered you. He saved you. He healed you. Now he starts to restore you because you've not yet become who you've called to be. And this is where the one who you start to think about, why was I saved? Why did Jesus put his hand on my life? What is for me? What has God got up his sleeve for me? And we see this where you start to understand that you were never intended to just get saved out of captive or even to learn better ways to think, but you will learn now how to live, really walk it out. And you start to cook with gas because you were never intended to live forever in confusion. You were never intended to live forever just getting by. You were never intended to live forever just existing, never breaking free. But now you access this cup by understanding why you were made and then starting to live it. So you need to say, okay, why? Why did God save me? Was it just so I could get saved? That's fantastic, but it's not the whole story. Was it just so I could learn how to live and be delivered out of harmful patterns? Yes, it's thankful for that, but it's not the end of the story. It's so that I can start to walk out a different life and I can start to understand what life is all about. And Ephesians 2 and 10 says, for we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which he's prepared in advance for you. I start to understand that I have destiny on my life, that I have purpose on my life, that he who began a good work in me is going to be faithful to complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. He's at work. He's got some good things for my life. And then we move to the cup of praise. Now, this is fantastic. This is another step in the journey of where God's taken. Some of you might be right here right now, but I want to tell you that there's more for you. Maybe you're right here. I want to tell you there's more for you. But right here is where God wants you to live. This is now living. This is living now. I think there's that song. This is living now. This is living now. Where I stop living for myself. I start living for Jesus and for a higher purpose than just my purpose. I start to live for him fully. Lord, my life is yours. My finances are yours. My marriage is yours. My work is yours. This is life to the full. This is great. It's not life to the full. This is great. It's not life to the full. This is great. It's not life to the full. This is where, and 1 Peter says it this way, a chosen people. You are a royal priesthood. You are a holy nation. You are God's holy possession. Why? So that you can show others the goodness of God. That there will be a praise out of your mouth that people will say, wow, what is going on? They were like this, but look at what God's doing. And that there flows out of you such kindness and goodness and love and peace and patience and gentleness and self-control that people can't help but say, there is a God. There is a God at work. You're no longer concerned about yourself, but you're best life is in and with the people of God, where you see your contribution, you find your community, and it's a place of celebration. And it's a place where I need to say to some people, take the mission trip. Write the book. Write the song. Start the business. What has God created you for to bring Him praise? Daniel and I were talking before the service, and he said, "This is this. Salvation, it's sanctified. I've been set apart." And I said, "It's this. It's not just this. It's not just this. It's not just this. It's not just this. It's this. The processing of God. Thank God that He saved me. Thank God that He delivered me. Thank God that He's restoring and redeeming me. But thankful to God that I can bring forth praise by the way I live my life, that people's hearts would be turned to God, that I can't help but stand and praise Him. I can't help but give Him glory. I can't help but give Him honor, because look what the Lord has done." Look what the Lord has done. I invite you to stand to your feet. I need my communion elements. It can stay here. You worship people, you'll figure out your way around this. On the bottom, do the bottom first. There's the bread or is on the bottom. But the beautiful thing is Jesus fulfilled all of this. He's the one who sanctifies and saves you. He's the one who delivers you. He's the one who redeems you. He's the one who you worship and bring forth praise. It's Jesus. So this morning, if you're a follower of Jesus, when we take this bread, we're reminding ourselves of this. If you need one in a room, I assumed everybody got one. Just put your hand up and they'll bring you one. Keep your hand up. There's Brian's right here. Brian, run over here. Run over there and grab it, Elena. Okay. Princeton is joining us this morning, so hopefully you have your communion cup. Mr. Jan and family up there, Praxis. We're going to take this with the understanding that we were made to bring forth praise to Jesus. We were made for more than survival. We were made to write songs. We were meant to write books. We were meant to see salvation. We were meant to raise godly kids. We were meant to have a multi-generational impact. We were meant to plant churches. We were meant, like, what has God created you for? Salvation, deliverance, redemption, bringing forth praise. So, Lord Jesus, we thank you for your body broken for us, that you went willingly to the cross. No one forced you to lay your body down. You willingly laid it down. And we remind ourselves, we proclaim your death again until you come. We thank you for your body broken for us, that as Hebrews 10 reminds us, that you opened a new and living way through your body into the presence of God. We don't have to come once a year or once a week. We can live in the presence of God. We're thankful for you, Jesus. Take your bread. You can open your cup of juice. This reminds us, start of the journey, that Jesus shed his blood for the forgiveness of our sin, for the healing of our body, for the restoring of our life, so that we can bring forth praise to Jesus. We give him praise. So, Jesus, we thank you for your blood shed for the forgiveness and the remission of sin. Thank you that your blood shed pays the price, the penalty for us. Thank you that your blood heals our body. Thank you that your blood restores our mind. Thank you that our your blood shed opens new possibilities for us, that we can be who we're called to be, that we can do what we're called to do because of the power and strength of Jesus in us, through us, and for us. Take the cup. That's all available if you're a follower of Jesus. But if you're not a follower of Jesus, this is just a nice illustration. If you're not a follower of Jesus, if you're not sure you're right with God, you can be made right with God. We've talked about it all through the service today. You can be made right with God. It's as simple as A, B, C. You'll hear me say this. One, I acknowledge that I'm a sinner in need of a Savior. I move out of denial and into the reality that I need a Savior. I cannot do it by myself. B, I believe that Jesus is the way, that he paid the price for my sin so that I can be reconciled to God and begin to live the life that he called me to live. And C, I confess that he's my Lord. He's the forgiver and leader of my life. I acknowledge, I believe, and I confess. So if there's anybody in the room that's ready to be made right with God, that's not sure that they're right with God right now, I want, in a moment, I'm going to ask you to raise your hand, not to embarrass you, but because I want to pray with you. And there's something about taking a step that begins the journey of what God has for you. But you got to start the journey. So you can turn a moment into momentum for your life. So if you're in the room in Princeton right now, if you're in the room right here, and if that's you and you're not sure you're right with God, and you say, Craig, I want to begin a journey and be made right with God, just throw up your hand in the room, wherever you are. I can't see very well. Yes. Yes. All right. Family, I'm going to invite you to pray. There's a couple hands in the room. People are beginning a journey of freedom with Jesus. If that's you, if it's your friend that's around, that go and stand with them and pray, and we're going to pray with them. Someone over here, someone back there, boldly just saying, I need Jesus. Jesus, we thank you. Family, can you pray with me? Jesus, we thank you that you came, died, and rose again to pay the price for my sin. I acknowledge that I'm a sinner in need of a Savior. Come into my life, forgive my sin, and make me new. You're the leader of my life. You're my Lord. I surrender my life to you. In the strong name of Jesus, amen and amen. Can I just tell you what just happened? A miracle happened in the room. Some people right now pass from death to life. Okay. That's what the Bible says. And the Bible says that heaven rejoices when a lost son or daughter returns home and starts the journey of walking into all that God created them for. Jesus, we thank you. I think the worship team's got a song, maybe. I don't know. Do we? Yeah. What do we got? As soon as I say amen, you'll do that. Okay. That's very subtle communication. Lord Jesus, we thank you. Just lift your hands if you're a follower of Jesus right now. Jesus, I thank you that you set me free. Save me. Jesus, I thank you that you deliver me. Thank you that you're delivering me. Thank you that you're redeeming me. That my best days are yet in front of me because of Jesus. Thank you that I can give you praise for your goodness. And I pray, Lord, that somehow my life would bring forth praise to you and honor to you. That people would see the work that you've done in my life and couldn't help but say there is a God. We look to you, Jesus. Your goodness and your kindness, we're grateful for it. In the strong name of Jesus, amen.
In response to what we've been hearing, what we've been praying, we're going to sing that chorus of fill me with your love and lead me out, that we want to respond to his grace. But before we get there, we'll just sing this refrain. And oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up. You're getting it. Let's just turn it to worship.
Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life.
One last time. Oh, praise.
Oh, praise the one who paid my debt.
Bless all the work of your hands. You will lend to many nations, but will borrow from none. I think it's a good thing to realize that in this space, we must start in the beginning of that sentence, the Lord. Not us, not our obedience for the sake of trying to get something from Him, but the Lord. It starts with the promise that He will send rain to the land, that He will open up the storehouse of His bounty, and it's our response to this promise that we ought to give in our tithes and our offerings, that it only makes sense to walk the narrow path that leads to life. And there's something beautiful here as we find ourselves in the moment of praise. I remember a story that's been still changing how I approach finances. And it was a story of these two Harvard students that went to this class in Harvard, and it was about God and money. And they realized these incredible things about the truth and reality of what it means to obey God in our finances. And they began to do a study where they went to the people who have already graduated from this class, and they were making lots of money. And they called them and asked them, hey, like, what are you doing with your finances now in response to the reality of what it means to obey God? And something incredible was happening as they had these conversations. See, these people found themselves with praise as they worship God with their finances, because through the phone, these people would, you can feel the joy going through the phone as they would be talking about how they would be making hundreds of thousands but be giving 80,000. Like, only 10% of their finances would go to themselves, and some of them would even begin to make more just so they could give more. And there was a sense in which for them, knowing that they're in Harvard and they can make a bunch of money, but they were missing out on something. They realized what it means to obey God in their finances was actually not just for the sake of, oh, fine, I'll do it, but it's the sake of joy. It's for the sake of the promise that God will bless the land. And there's a sense in which it all ends with the reality that we can lend to others and find joy in them. And to get to that place takes a step. I'll give my offering this week. Give my offering next week. When I get my payments, I'll give it all. I'll give it then as well. And we come to this place where we can find joy, to realize that this need to have a hold on our lives. So as the ushers come, let us reflect on that and let us challenge ourselves. And as we move forward in this, we can really see what it means to live in the kingdom of God. So as the ushers come, the baskets are going to pass from your right to your left, and then we'll watch a video, but I'll pray as they come forward. So Father, we thank you that you have a process in mind for us that leads us to life. So Father, we pray that as we give our finances, as we give our hopes and our beliefs towards you, Lord, that you just begin to bless as we lay down our lives for you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Come on, so you can pass the offerings over and then we'll watch a video up front.
We're pretty honest.
And we're also really raw. It's because we talk about our struggles and the pain we've been through.
You're trying to find your happiness from your spouse and you don't find it there.
These are men, and I'm looking for my husband. This Good. One's really tall. This one has lots of hair.
Overrated. Overrated.
Of all the men in the world, I choose you. But then we're married a while, and suddenly, I didn't notice before, but you have this brown leaf. So we're going, I think, this is awesome. Jesus is with me. But then I start going the same places that I always went, and Jesus is like, no, I got this. Like, I know where to go. And it's my job to fix you because something's wrong with you.
You think, yeah, I want my spouse to change. Then our marriage could work. And I'm telling you, don't go there.
What would it look like if I allowed him to be in total and complete control? All right, Lord, I give you everything. It's all good for a while, right? But then it's like, wait, you don't talk, you don't listen, you don't lead, you don't pray, you don't spend time with the boys, you don't do all these things. Me, my needs. No, I never said that I would go there. No, you know, I'm gonna help you. Let me help you, Jesus. I'm trying to get this thing. Like, Lord, no, like, don't do that. Like, no, here, I'm gonna help you.
And,
have you ever done this?
We're trying to find life horizontal from a person, from an amount of money, from a job, from a thing, but we're actually looking in the wrong place. We have to take our eyes off of each other and say, okay, God, I want to find life from you. And let me tell you, when you do vertical marriage the way God designed marriage, I'm telling you, it can change your entire legacy.
Come on. Well, hey, if you are engaged or you are married in the house today, we have an awesome marriage conference coming up April 12th to 13th. And some people have been asking, like, what's the deal? If you are married, this is going to be a great opportunity. Yeah. If your marriage is in a great spot and maybe you've gone through things like this and you've gone through the motions and you're in that place of praise, there are people that need to hear your story. There's couples that need to know that what they're living in is not all that there is in their marriage. And if you're in a place where you're like, God, I need you to come in and help, this is a great opportunity for you. I know as a husband, there's times where you can be killing it at work. You can be killing it maybe in different hobbies. You can be in the best father. But one of the areas that can be hardest for husbands, we want to kill it as a husband. But women, you guys are sometimes a little confusing. And the reality is that I know every man in this room that would be a husband or is maybe engaged to be, you want to thrive in this area. You want to do well. But sometimes it's hard to say, hey, what does this look like? How do I do this? And in whatever spectrum it is, I want to encourage you. I think we have 20 spots for couples left. So you can go to horizonfam.ca, register to go. It's going to be a great weekend, a Friday night and a Saturday. There's going to be that couple will be doing some of the video content. There'll be some discussion, food. It's going to be a great time. No matter where you are in your marriage, we'd love to invite you out. It's going to be good.
100%. And also with that, for today, our second announcement is that we actually have the welcome to the team party going to happen right after service. And if you
like in 2 minutes.
Pretty much 2 minutes. So gotcha. If you're registered, you kind of know the deal. It's going to be over there. But if you want to join team here at Horizon and you're part of the fam, we would love for you to just come on by and you can sign up for a team. And yep, it should be a good time.
And so Pastor Craig actually hit on something, the idea of discovering what you're called to do, that Ephesians 2:10. Can I tell you right now, if you call Horizon home and you've yet to find your place of service, I would love to invite you to come just hear about some of the opportunities of where to find that place to serve. Because finding a place to serve on team, one, it makes the body better, but it's also practice. Serving on a team is going to help you discover what it is that God has called you. Sunday morning's not the be-all, end-all. Sunday morning is a chance to come and celebrate so that Monday to Saturday, we can do everything that Christ has called us to out there as well. So if you're new, don't yet serve on a team, or it's been a while since you've served on a team, we would love to invite you in the music room right after service. We've got some lunch. You'll hear about teams. Other than that,
have a blessed Sunday.
All right. Have a good Sunday.
See ya.